ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. My name is Duncan Brown, and I am with the Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Lab. Welcome to this, the seventh session in the 11th year of the Rethinking Seminar Series. This year, the series is sponsored by the Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Lab. Each year, the Rethinking Seminar Series focuses on an aspect of national and international security issues. Our seminar theme this year is Rethinking Global Security Constructs, Threats, and Responses. The specific topic areas that we are trying to cover this year include potential threats, adversaries, and strategies the United States should consider over the next few decades, where, when, how, and should the U.S. military engage, the post-World War II international order, U.S. leadership, international organizations, and multilateralism, basic U.S. strengths, including its economic strength, its place in the world, and their relationship to global security, and finally, the economic, trade, and security between and among the European Union, the United States, and East Asia. Before introducing tonight's speaker, a few quick announcements. First, all of our seminar talks are videotaped and posted on our website. Additionally, we post bulletized notes and presentation materials that our speakers provide to us. To find the site, you simply type in three words into Google, JHU, Rethinking, and Seminar, and it should pop up as the number one site. The second announcement is that in order to properly videotape our events, we do use wireless microphones. And unfortunately, cell phones, PDAs, and wireless devices do directly interfere with the recording system and those wireless mics. So as a courtesy, I would ask that everyone please turn off all electronic communication devices at this time. The third announcement is that our next speaker will be on April 27th, and he will be Troy Thomas, the Director for Strategic Planning, the President's National Security Council. He will be here to discuss the 2015 U.S. National Security Strategy, its formulation, its key principles, and its priorities. And now for tonight's speaker. Ms. Christine Fox is currently the Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Lab, or APL for short, Director for Policy and Analysis. In her new role, she is responsible for leading efforts to increase APL's engagement on national issues and to contribute to national security and space policies. Prior to APL, Ms. Fox served in some very notable positions. She was the Acting Deputy Secretary of Defense, the Director of the Cost Assessment and Program Evaluation Office for the Office of the Secretary of Defense, and finally, the President of the Center for Naval Analysis. Tonight, Ms. Fox will discuss how the U.S. can continue to innovate, even in an overly constrained budget environment, so as to stay ahead of potential adversaries. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Ms. Christine Fox.
Thank you, Duncan. Thank you, Duncan, very much for that introduction and for everything that you do for these Rethinking seminars. I think that they've been a great series, and it's great to have an opportunity to bring so many experts together to debate and discuss difficult issues. And thank you all for coming tonight. It's nice to see so many old friends. It's wonderful to be here with you. Tonight, for my remarks, I want to pick up one of Duncan's themes, basic U.S. strengths. And I hope to suggest to you tonight that the basic U.S. strength of having a modern, capable military is something that we actually expect as a nation. And we're right to expect it, in my view. And in my view, we have a very modern, capable military, the best military in the world. But there's a difference between expecting it and taking it for granted. And I fear that we are at a place in our history where we may be taking it for granted. And I think that that is in evidence by the fact that we are not investing in it. So tonight, I want to talk to you about three things. First, I want to talk to you a little bit more about the impact of the budget on the ability of our military to sustain its technological edge. Secondly, I do want to talk a little bit about the environment in the Defense Department, and I want to submit to you that it's overconstrained from the perspective of creating an environment of innovation necessary to sustain our technological edge. And finally, I want to offer a few ideas for ways to mitigate these effects, things that we're working on at APL. Okay, so number one, the budget. Now, I understand this is a very well-informed audience, and I understand all of you track the budget, but you're just going to have to indulge me. I did five budgets, people. Okay, I have to talk to you about the budget because I think it's really, really important. And I am going to drag you through a few numbers, but not too many. But they're important, and I think we should take just a minute and focus on them. And I want to start this little journey on 1 March 2013. That is the day sequester was imposed. And $37 billion was mechanistically taken out of the defense budget for that very fiscal year, from 1 March to the end of September. Now, leading up to that event, the department, Secretary Panetta, myself, we all used terms like it would be devastating. Sequester is going to be devastating. And I think we talked about devastating so much that the world seemed to expect that on March 2nd, 2013, there wouldn't be a military, right? It'd just fall off the cliff. Nothing happened. We still have a military. Oh, sequester is not a problem, right? How many times have you heard sequester wasn't a problem? I heard it a lot, trust me. And I understand that, you know, when you say devastating, you expect to see devastating results right away. But unfortunately, it just doesn't work that way. But don't be confused. It was devastating. It was devastating in multiple ways. And the department is still recovering from the effects of sequester. First, it was devastating in the area of readiness, which is not the topic of our discussion tonight, but I do want to say a couple words about readiness, because readiness is a concept that is not really embraced in Washington. There's no constituency for readiness, as Vice Chairman Winnefeld says, and it's true. But let's just think about it for a minute. It's really not that hard. You have people, and you want them to do very hard things, so you need to train them to do it. And when they do those hard things, they do it with equipment, like the car in your driveway. You got to change the oil. You got to change the tires. And when it breaks, you got to get parts and you got to fix it. That's maintenance. So training and maintenance is basically readiness. So what did sequester do to that? Well, it canceled training events. Just canceled them. There wasn't any money for it. So we have commanders deployed today who never went through the National Training Center. Those commanders cannot go back in their careers and get that experience. It is lost. There is a swath of our military leadership in all of the services that missed important training events in their career, and they will never get that back. And that's a hole. Now let's talk about the maintenance side. The depots, well, we had to furlough people, right? Couldn't afford to sustain the depots at the same pace. So backlogs, right? Depot backlogs. All the services have depot backlogs. Well, sequester did end, but the money didn't go up. We couldn't pay overtime to build down that backlog. So that backlog is snaking through those depots, but it's still that big bulge. It's still there, and they're still dealing with it. So readiness was very definitely affected. Modernization was affected too. There's a very, very smart person at IDA named Dave McNichols, and Dave was actually the head of the cost assessment part of PA&E, the predecessor to CAPE. Dave and I did not overlap when I was in the Pentagon, but I certainly knew him and met him and knew of his work. And he's just done a wonderful study about the cost of acquisition programs. And what Dave was looking for was a correlation of acquisition reform initiatives in our history and program performance. Well, he didn't find any correlation, which is disappointing to all of those working on acquisition reform all the time. But Dave, undeterred, went on and looked for other correlations, and guess what? The biggest contributor to program cost growth was budget downturns. Budget downturns was the biggest contributor in his study to program cost growth. Now, once you see his result and you think about it, it's not surprising, right? What did we do in 2013? Well, we did what I call the slips and slides. You take a program, you stretch it out. You stretch out the payments. You stretch it out in terms of the acquisition. You slip forward a modernization thing that breaks deals with the contractors. They have to adjust for that. The price goes up. So at a time when the department needed to be as efficient as was possible, and rightly, the Congress and the people were demanding that the department be as efficient as possible, sequestration pushed it in their acquisition programs to be as inefficient as possible. and the costs of all of those programs grew. And again, the department is still paying for that today. Okay, so hopefully I've convinced you sequester is not the goal, right? We don't want sequester. So what happened at the end of that? Well, we got the Bipartisan Budget Act, and that gave us much needed stability for FY14 and FY15. We were so excited in the department. I remember getting it. It's like, shoo, finally stability. We danced a jig about stability. We didn't talk very much about the fact that it cut $75 billion out of the budget for 2 years. Yes, we got stability. They also took a big hit to the budget. So that $75 billion was relative to the president's budget 14. Now, I have to anchor here again just a minute and explain why that's an important budget. And all other budgets seem to be, continue to this day, to be measured against that budget. The reason for that is that that was the budget that was designed to support the Defense Strategic Guidance. I'm not going to go through all the tenets of the Defense Strategic Guidance. I believe most of you in this room know what those are. But I am struck by the fact that in a town when nobody likes anything, very little negative has been said about the Defense Strategic Guidance. There might have been some negative things said about whether or not we're achieving the Defense Strategic Guidance, fair. But the tenets of the guidance itself have been remarkably supported. And they were, again, refined and reaffirmed in last year's QDR. So we get the guidance, and we do a program, and we align the program to the guidance, and then we figure out how much it's going to cost. And that was the budget that was submitted in 14. And so when we get to the Bipartisan Budget Act and we say it cut $75 billion, it cut $75 billion relative to that budget, the budget necessary to achieve the strategy. But still, the handwriting was on the wall, right? The budget's going down, and the Budget Control Act sequester level funding would still come back into effect in FY16 if nothing else happened. So the last budget that I did submit a budget that was lower than President's Budget 14, but it was still $115 billion higher than the Budget Control Act. And the budget that Secretary Work has on the Hill right now said that was too low, and they've added up another $12 billion. Despite all of this review, and all of this analysis, and all of this assessment, and all of the ability to justify the money, it still is true that sequester will happen in FY16. So at this point, I'd like to quote Secretary Work and say, stop the madness, please, just stop the madness. It's going to have, once again, devastating effects. Sequester comes back in FY16, it will cut $35 billion in that year alone. So it is significant, and those are the numbers. Okay, so I'm finished dragging you through the numbers, but I want to talk a little bit about what it means. And I know this picture looks amazingly simple, right? It's so simple, it can't tell us much, but I want to walk you through something here where I think it really does tell us a lot. So if you think about this as a picture of a balanced force in the ideal, and you look at the bottom of my triangle there, I've got cost of ownership. Now that's related to force structure. Force structure we typically think of as ships and planes and tanks, and that's all true. But the things that run the ships and the planes and the tanks are people, and people have to be paid. So just like when you do your budget at home, there's things that have to be paid that come off the top. The salaries of the people of the Defense Department come off the top. And that is the cost of ownership. And that is fixed by the size of the force. Now, ideally, you would like to have a budget relative to that cost of ownership that allows you to have a ready force, trained and maintained, and a modern force. A force where we don't just replace the stuff we use, although that's in modernization, or we don't just incrementally upgrade the stuff that we use, also in modernization, but things where we're actually innovative, where we do big things, things that have always given the United States military its technological edge. That's in modernization. So that's what we would like to have. And this is what we have with the president's budget. Now, we didn't want to submit a budget where the triangle was out of kilter. In fact, the department proposed for that base of the triangle reductions in force and reductions in pay. Not reductions in pay overall, but slowed the growth. Changes, you know, not as great of salary increases as we had done in the past. Some changes to the co-pays for healthcare and so forth. Congress worked with us on some of those things, but not nearly the full package that we proposed. And they denied an awful lot of the force structure cuts, whether it was A-10s or ships or U-2s. So that base got kind of fixed, but the budget did go down. So we're out of balance for readiness and modernization. And this is our sequester picture. It just gets worse, okay? It just gets worse. So the other thing that's really important about this really squished triangle is to think about our potential adversaries. Are they living with this picture? I don't think so. They're investing a lot. They're fielding rapidly. Their capabilities are expanding quickly. And a lot of people have been talking about this. I know, again, this is a very informed audience. You know about this. But we are running the risk of not keeping pace and not being able to sustain our technological edge. And I also ask you to look at that picture and ask yourselves, does that look like an environment of innovation to you? Does that look like a world where people are thinking of great new ideas that we can field in the future, no matter how expensive they are? Of course not. The services are holding on. The operational demands are up. Nothing comes off the table. Russia, it's the end of the Cold War. Not so fast. There's Ukraine, right? Think about what's going on with China. Nation states, you know, we like to say, oh, nation state conflicts, that's not a problem anymore. Not true. And then there's terrorism. That's on the rise. And then you look at the Middle East. Well, we're going to get out of Iraq and Afghanistan. Yeah, okay, but there's ISIS. And look at just today what's going on in Yemen. So the world is not cooperating either. So we really do have some challenges. The services are doing their level best to meet these challenges. And I can't say enough good things about all of the things that they are doing. However, it is a real challenge, and they are struggling. So in a struggling world, where does innovation fit? So that's what I want to talk about next. So, innovation. We have a budget constraint, tried to make that case. And then there's also the environment of the department. There's the expectations of programs, the expectation the department can say exactly what it needs, exactly how long it's going to take to develop it, and exactly how much it's going to cost. And if there's much variation on that, it's considered a failed program. And there's a process called Nunn-McCurdy, for those of you who are familiar with it, where you basically start over if you exceed the time and growth by too much, and you have to reassess whether it's important and reassess whether it's designed right and so forth. So it's viewed as an onerous setback by a lot of people. So it's not that the department leadership doesn't recognize this problem and isn't worried about it. Secretary Kendall, Secretary Work, Secretary Carter now, they all have innovation initiatives, and I think there's been a lot of dialogue about that, whether it's the Secretary's Innovation Initiative or the LIRDIP, which I won't remember all the words that's in that acronym, but it's something about long-range development planning. And the department, in every one of these painful budgets I just drug you through, tried to protect S&T dollars preferentially, even though the budget was going down, because everybody recognized that was our seed corn for the future. You've got to have that. So it's recognized, but it's still a problem. It's still a challenge. And I want to talk through an innovative company's view of what it takes to be innovative as we think about whether or not the Defense Department is over-constrained with regard to innovation. So this is the Google 9. Google puts out their principles of innovation. There's lots of innovative companies. Others do it differently. But let's just, if we will, stick with Google for tonight. So first of all, this list, the one thing that jumps out that the Defense Department has in common with Google is have a mission that matters. DoD and the military, they have a big mission that matters. But now let's explore a couple of the other principles here. The first ones I want to talk about are bet on technical insights and fail well. Those are our Google principles. And I want to use the B2 story to illustrate some of this with regard to the Defense Department. So kind of going back in history, in the late 1970s, Lockheed Martin and Northrop Grumman both were starting on stealth programs. Lockheed Martin was able to develop and field the F-117 amazingly quickly, very, very fast. And they did it because they already had computational models that would allow them to design and estimate the cross-section of a process where they took flat plates and put them together in faceted configurations. Any of you who have seen an F-117 knows it doesn't look pretty. It's a little odd looking, and a lot of people thought it was a little odd looking. But it did decrease the cross-section because that reflected the radar. And they fielded it fast, and it did great in Desert Storm, and it set stealth kind of on a path and out there. And it was a major achievement. But it had a few problems. First of all, it was pretty hard to fly. Secondly, it had some big maintenance problems. And finally, the degree to which you could reduce the radar cross-section was limited by the design. Okay, so same time frame, in parallel, Northrop Grumman started down a different path. And they decided they were going to push advances in computational fluid dynamics. Those advances in that field allowed for them to design curved surfaces that still reduced the radar cross-section. And once you got that design, then the limits on stealth got less and they were able to do more. Now, this is all good news and it resulted in the B-2. But I think for anybody who really knows about the B-2, it's generally not considered a successful program. In fact, I would say that a lot of people think of the B-2 as the poster child for a failed program. In fact, it was 18 years from inception to initial operational capability. And by the time they were done, they reduced the buy from 132 planes to 20. The average cost of each of those 20 aircraft was $2 billion per plane. Okay, so when we think of overruns today, you know, they don't really compare. This is a big overrun. But I would like to argue to you that it failed well. Because every stealth program that has come after the B-2 has benefited from the advancements that they made in that program on computational fluid design. And the curved surfaces and the ability to reduce the radar cross-section through that way has opened doors for follow-on stealth aircraft. So what about today? Would we have a B-2 program today? I don't think so. I think it would be awfully difficult to go into a program like that, either because of the budget or because of the expectations of acquisition programs today. So I think, you know, we're going to come back to what to do about that. And I am not advocating that programs of record should be allowed to overrun so extensively. However, I am arguing that if every time we start something, we have to know exactly what it's going to be and exactly how long it's going to take, it's going to stifle innovation. The next one I want to talk about is innovation comes from anywhere. Now, I think a lot of you are probably expecting I'm going to talk about commercialization. And you know, that's an important trend. In the past, the Defense Department was responsible in our nation roughly for two-thirds of the innovation, and the commercial sector was responsible for about one-third. And today that's flipped. As I'm sure you're aware, the commercial sector is responsible for more like two-thirds of the innovations coming out of the U.S., and the Defense Department is more responsible for one-third. And this is a trend, and it's something we need to think about. I'll touch on this a little bit more later. And we have to figure out how to get innovation from anywhere in the commercial sector, and that's true. But that's not what I want to talk about here. What I want to talk about here are innovation comes from anywhere from our people. And I want to use the example of the Cold War for that. So back in the old, bad old days of the Cold War and the Soviet threat, the Navy instituted a program called the TACD&E program, Tactics Development and Evaluation. Google advocates a flat structure. Most of us don't think about the military as the epitome of a flat structure. But the TACD&E program was actually pretty flat. There was an office in OpNav that was responsible for funding it, but any squadron and any ship anywhere out in the fleet could come up with tactics ideas, and there was a process by which they flowed up and competed. And the best ideas got some funding. The funding went for a couple of purposes. One was to get some analytic help. I was a tech D&E analyst at CNA, and so I'm very familiar with this program. And it also gave them some opportunities to experiment. So the experimentation would come from the addition onto a training exercise, whether it was a flying exercise or a strike group exercise. They would tag on 1, 2, 3 days of flying or steaming at the end of the exercise to try out these tactics ideas that typically came from lieutenants. Lieutenants like the current vice chairman, Admiral Winnefeld, who was a part of this program at the same time. So I look around this room, and I know there's several of you who won't know these names, but I see a few faces that probably will. You heard of Vector Logic, Chainsaw, Silent Sam, Radar Shadowing, Counter Targeting? Every one of those tactics came out of this process at this time, and they all came from the people. They came from the lower levels, the junior levels, the guys that were fresh to the problem and being innovative. So what about today? I don't think we have this going today in the military. On the battlefield you do. On the battlefield you do. We know, and we've all heard stories of guys on the battlefield where they figure something out about the IED threat and through text and email it goes through the fleet or the operating forces like wildfire. That's important. But for this process, for sustaining our technological edge, for thinking about our future programs, do we have anything like this? I don't think so. And even if we did, how would we experiment with it? I just went through an exhaustive and probably boring budget description about all the impacts on readiness. They're barely holding on to proficiency. How could they possibly add 2, 3 days of steaming or flying to experiment with something that nobody has any idea if it's really going to work? And it's okay, by the way, if it failed because we learned something. So I think we need to get back to that. And again, I want to recognize that the department is aware of this. I think that the department understands that they've got to get back to an ability to have experimentation in a safe place. And various flag officers and general officers I've talked with, they know that and they're working on it. But it's hard. It's just so tight. It's just very, very constrained. The last one I want to talk about is Google's process of ship and iterate. So Google has, in their innovation design, they come up with ideas and they put them out there and they get feedback and then they bring them back and they change them and they put them out again. This is part of their principles of innovation. So I'm going to submit to you that that doesn't work so well for DoD, at least not the way DoD does programs today. And I want to use the Joint Strike Fighter, one of my favorite programs, as an example. So at the beginning of the Joint Strike Fighter, Lockheed Martin proposed to the department that the advances in modeling and simulation was such that we didn't need to do as much developmental testing with flying as we have in the past. That those models, those simulations, those advances in design and development were such that we could actually start a low-rate production of airplanes concurrent, that's the acquisition speak, or at the same time as we do developmental testing. And that'll be good, okay? So this was thought at the time to be win-win for everybody. It's a win for the military because all the services start to get the capabilities of the Joint Strike Fighter much earlier than they normally would if they had to wait till it went through all of the developmental and operational testing. And they were hungry for the capabilities, and they thought this is a good thing. So even if the planes need a little bit of modding, it's not going to be a big deal. Lockheed Martin wins because, frankly, industry's profits come when they start production. They don't make a lot of profit in the developmental phase. And so they want to get to production as quickly as they can, and this allowed them to get to production faster. So the department and Lockheed Martin shook hands and agreed to a highly concurrent program. So now I want to read you a quote from the GAO in 2012. "Most of the instability in the program has been and continues to be the result of highly concurrent development, testing, and production. DoD is still investing billions of dollars on hundreds of aircraft while flight testing still has years to go." And that absolutely was the situation in 2012. And Secretary Kendall took a lot of production out of that program, and he flattened the ramp of production, and he seriously cut back on the concurrency. That's where they are today, because they're still testing and finding things. And that helped a lot to stabilize the program. But ship and iterate just may not work for programs like JSF, right? It's just, maybe we shouldn't try that one again. Maybe we should learn from that. But could it work? Could we find a way to bring ship and iterate into the Defense Department? Well, I think you might be able to. I think if instead of thinking about it as part of a big major program, the biggest in the department's history, you thought of it instead as something that happened before you went to a program of record, where you built prototypes of innovative systems, and then you got them out to the operating forces, and you found some way to get them a little experimentation time in a safe environment where they could fail well, and you could learn from that experience, and you could crank it back in. And you could do it all over again until you knew enough about an innovative technology that you could then say, yes, this is what I need, this is how long I think it's going to take to develop it, and this is how much I think it's going to cost. And then start your program of record. If we could get to that, then I think we might be able to get more than just the ship and iterate principles of innovation into the Defense Department. But there's a lot of things that have to change to do that. But I think it might actually be doable. Okay, so kind of doom and gloom, budgets doom and gloom, over-constrained environment kind of doom and gloom. So now I want to shift to some of the possible mitigations. And I want to talk about three approaches that we're currently working on at APL. The first is develop practically, the second is develop thoughtfully, and the first is develop broadly. So to start, I want to talk a little bit about develop practically. And to do that, I want to think about the technology of autonomy. So, okay, I don't know about you guys, but I don't think I've gone to a topic or a speech or a conference on innovation where autonomy hasn't been front and center, the big bet, the future. Okay, and I guess that's true tonight too, right? I'm talking about autonomy. But there's so many ideas out there. I have heard amazing concepts for autonomy. We're going to have smart autonomous systems that are able to operate individually and know exactly when to do whatever it is they're supposed to do. And then there's swarms of autonomy, and all of these systems in the autonomous swarms are going to do things. Okay, so there's lots of ideas of things we could build. And to be honest, at APL, that same thing is going on. We're coming up with lots of cool ideas for autonomy that we could build. But develop practically, I mean, we need to do some hard work up front to think about what we should build. And to illustrate that, I want you to think about all these ideas you've heard, and I know you've heard them, and put them in a big funnel. And in that funnel, I want you to think about having filters so that the ideas have to get through those filters so that at the bottom, they come out with the things that we should build. And the first filter I want to suggest to you is man versus machine. So APL has actually done a lot of research on this topic, a lot of brain research, a lot of working with what machines are better at than humans. And they've looked into the future and sort of how long are these trends likely to occur. So yes, it's evolving, and yes, it will change. But building practically, let's think about it. Machines are really, really good at programs that can be developed pretty simply, but that are maybe very data intensive. I'm going to use Google Maps, right? I now go out to Laurel, Maryland every day, and I live in Alexandria, Virginia. Google Maps is my friend. Every morning I check Google Maps and it tells me, what's the fastest route? Should I go the parkway? Should I go over 14th Street? Should I go around the Beltway? And sometimes as I'm going, it comes up and says, oop, 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 traffic alert, we should go this way now. Okay, I could never figure that out without Google Maps, never. It's perfect. It's a perfect use of a machine. Another perfect use of a machine is persistent stare. I think we believe at APL anyway, and some of our of our research is predicated on the fact that humans are still going to be the best at complex pattern recognition. But we get bored and we get tired when we have to stare at the same space for very long periods of time, right? So if you've got a section of Earth that you need to stare at and you want to know if something happens there, somebody comes in, something goes out, and you need to stare at it 24/7, human beings are terrible for that. First, their mind wanders. Machines don't have minds to wander. Secondly, their eyes get tired. Machines don't have eyes that get tired. Eventually, they just miss stuff, and machines don't miss things. So persistent stare is another really wonderful use of a machine. Let's talk about the human side. Well, humans are uniquely capable of determining intent, at least today. Intent based on body language, intent based on context, intent based on facial expressions. Machines aren't very good at that. Our lab director, Dr. Ralph Semmel, has something I just love when we talk about this issue. He says, let me talk about autonomous systems when somebody can get a spell checker that actually doesn't change the meaning of my sentence. How many of you have sent texts or emails and looked back and saw that it automatically changed a word for you to help you, but it completely missed the intent, right? Completely missed the intent. So when intent is necessary, humans are better. Again, for now and the foreseeable future. So if we don't have a dollar to waste and we're going to build practically, we should probably pay attention to that as we think about man versus machine. The next filter in my funnel is legal and ethical norms. And this is pretty clear. There's very clear policy today that says that any autonomous system has to be compliant with the laws of armed conflict, which in a nutshell means you have to be able to be proportionate in your response, and you have to be able to discriminate the types of targets, civilian versus military. And it goes on to say that any application of force must have a human in the loop, period, done. So, what should we build going through our funnel? Well, you know, the little picture there on the left is the Autonomous Aerial Cargo Utility System. It's an ONR naval prototype program, and it's designed to autonomously deliver cargo. The Army has a convoy, an autonomous convoy that they're building that can autonomously do a logistics chain. I think this seems like a wonderful use of autonomy today. First of all, those are vulnerable for humans. And we all know that logistics chains are targeted, and so people are at risk in these. Secondly, it's route planning, right? A to B, they can do that. So this is a perfect use. I already talked about persistent stare and ISR, another, I think, very promising use. So there's a lot of things that we can do practically today with autonomy that could be game changers, but that don't push on the boundaries of man versus machine or legal and ethical norms. So now I want to move on to the concept of develop thoughtfully. And to do that, I want to stick with our theme of autonomy. And I want to also go back to our friend Google. And I want to submit to you that perhaps Google did not develop thoughtfully when they thought about Google Glass. So I imagine a lot of you remember when Google Glass was introduced. It was a game changer. It was too cool. If you were going to be photographed, you wanted to be wearing Google Glass. I don't care if you were a high-end fashion model or some commentator on television or whoever. And certainly, you had to be wearing them if you were a techie because it was so cool. And it was cool, very promising, except for the fact that people didn't think about, you know, with the blink of an eye, I can record something. What are you recording? What are you going to do with it? Are you recording it about me? Are you going to put it out on Facebook? Are you following me into the men's room? I'm not too happy with that. So privacy concerns came out in a big way. And of course, as you know, Google Glass has been pulled off the market. There were some other problems with it, some maintenance problems, some issues, but the big pushback was privacy, and it was banned in a lot of areas. So I want to think about that for autonomous systems for the future. Okay, so I've just talked about legal and ethical norms today, and I've talked about the fact that today the policy says any lethal use of autonomy must involve a human. I've heard a lot of people say, just got to get rid of that policy. That policy is bad. It's holding us back. We just got to get rid of that policy. Well, policy is a reflection of the people, and the people are a part of our culture, and we can understand and look at our cultural norms. And that's something we've done at APL. And so the cultural norms with regard to robots and autonomy fall into four categories. The first category is that technology won't be able to meet the moral and legal principles of warfare, those laws of armed conflict. Now, this is a huge debate in the autonomous community right now. And there are many who suggest that robots will be better at it because they're not emotional. They won't get upset if their buddy is killed and take out people they should not take out, which we all know has happened in all of the conflicts in our history. But there's a lot of people who don't accept it, and it's debated, okay? So that's a cultural norm where surveys show that most of our people are concerned about it. So you can't just wave it away. Even if you think that robots might be better, if you just say it louder, it isn't going to convince them. We got to find a way to convince people if we want to build lethal autonomous systems. The second cultural norm is that autonomous systems will lower the threshold for war, that we'll be more willing to engage in warfare because we aren't putting our own people at risk. So that's a concern. The third one, I think, is very important as well, and that is this notion of responsibility. If something goes wrong with an autonomous system, who's responsible? So my former organization, CNA, came up with a wonderful concept that has hung with me for a long time called lethal responsibility, and how in any conflict or to do training or to figure out things, you really need to know who in that chain has lethal responsibility. So now I want you to imagine a robot that mistakenly killed civilians, took out a church or a school or a wedding party by accident. It was a mistake. Who's responsible? Who's responsible? Software designer? The builder? The guy, the poor commander who sent the robot into the battle, is he responsible? Who's responsible, the president? We don't really have an answer to this question. And until we can answer who's responsible, we're not gonna be using lethal systems in autonomously, and that at least is my premise. Because whenever we have had situations like that, and we always have had situations like that, we have gone in and traced back responsibility for one of two purposes. One is accountability, or if it was a genuine accident, what do we need to change so it doesn't happen again, right? So until we can identify lethal responsibility for autonomous systems, I think lethality is gonna be a hard bar. And even if we can figure it out, we're gonna have to convince people. The last one is that a very common view is that robots will lead to a dystopian society. And for that, I simply need to call upon our movies. How many of you have seen a movie where mankind builds an army of really strong, powerful, autonomous, lethal robots, and it comes out well in the end, and everybody's happy? Anybody? Right, not many. We have a lot of examples where people really fear this, and it shows up. I understand there's four movies coming out this year alone touching on this topic. Now, it would be nice if we could say to people, it's just the movies, trust us, we're building data. Data's our friend. Data's our partner. He's going to be with us, and he's going to be a good guy, and he's going to be a good example of a robot with lethal capability. But people aren't convinced, and we're going to have to figure out how to convince them. And first, we're going to have to figure out how to build them. And so these are attitudes about autonomy that drive our policy. And if we don't like our policy, we're going to have to work on these attitudes. So when I say develop thoughtfully, I'm saying that we shouldn't just say this is stupid or people are unreasonable and dismiss it. We should embrace it. We should say, yep, nope, these are our cultural norms. And any system that we build, we're going to have to convince people that we have addressed those concerns. We're going to have to build something in to our autonomous systems of the future that gives you lethal responsibility. I don't know what it is. But I'll bet if we all worked on it, we could figure it out. And I'll bet we could get there in the future if we thought about it and built it in. But we've got to look at it seriously first. So the last idea that I want to talk to you about is an idea associated with develop broadly. And to develop broadly, I want to call up an idea that we've coined called tech on the shelf. Now, what do I mean by develop broadly? I know that you've all heard Secretary Work talk about the third offset strategy. It's a very important strategy, a very important concept. And we've had offset strategies in our past that have been very important to us. And I applaud him for trying to drive innovation into our thinking, even in this over-constrained environment. But even Secretary Work calls them the third offset strategies, because there really isn't a threat, there really isn't a challenge, and there really isn't a technology to meet that challenge. It's very complex. As I said before, it's everything from near peer competitor nation state conflict to ISIS and terrorism and everything in between. So you have this broad spectrum of concerns, and they're going to need a broad spectrum of technologies. And we don't have any money to field anything. But we have protected S&T in the budget. I said that before. It's a part where everybody recognized we got to protect our seed corn for the future. So we've protected it, and people are thinking of things, and they're spending that S&T, and where is it going? What are they doing with it? Well, we've got to capture it, that's my view. We've got to harness it, and we've got to put it on the shelf. And what do I mean by the shelf? So again, I'm going to call on the movies, and I want you to think about Batman, and I want you to think about when Bruce Wayne goes down to the basement of Wayne Enterprises and meets Lucius Fox. And he discovers that Wayne Enterprises has an S&T department, and the department's output is in that basement. And in Lucius Fox's basement, he finds first armored gear, right? New forms of wearable armor, and suddenly the Batsuit is darn, they've spray painted it black, off and running. He found a fabric, you shake it and it stiffens, and so now he can fly. And he found this guy that was designed to jump over water, pulling cables behind it to establish a bridge in combat. Okay, he couldn't get that bridge part to work, but as they say, this guy worked just fine. So, paint it black, Batmobile. We need Lucius Fox's basement, folks. We need that. That's what I mean by tech on the shelf. How can we possibly come up with ideas that we can harness and put on the shelf and have ready for when we need them or when the money comes back? Now, we've also been looking at this at APL, and it sounds really good, and the movie's a nice analogy, but it's actually really hard, and it's been tried in the past. So what are the things that we learned? We learned that, first of all, you put a prototype on the shelf, ConOps go past it, ideas go past it, technology modernizes, you get to it, you look at it, it's not relevant anymore, you throw it out. Okay, so that's a problem. Another problem is that when you build a whole system, especially with networks and communications, they just don't integrate when you field them downstream. But it's not insurmountable, right? It tells you some things. It tells you you don't build whole things, you build components. It tells you that if you go to a prototype, you take it off the shelf and you look at it and you modernize it and you get it out to the fleet in this wonderful experimentation world we're going to build for the future, where they're able to work with it and get their ConOps aligned. And so it's more of a dynamic shelf. And yes, it's going to take some money, and yes, it's going to take some oversight, and that costs money. But I think that if we don't figure this out, we may not be ready for when there is an upturn, and we do have a need to get new technology out there to maintain our technological edge. So I think that what I've tried to say tonight is that this is an over-constrained environment, and sustaining our technological edge is definitely a challenge, if not at risk. But I think if we pull together and we think of some different ways of approaching this problem, we push on the department to do some different things, we put together some different programs, we have a chance of being ready. And I want to close with this last quote. This is from Secretary Kendall, who is with all of these ideas. And this is what he says, and he's right. Every downturn is followed by an upturn, and the trick is to be ready for that upturn so that we can field programs quickly, we can sustain our technological edge, and we can work those triangles back up into balance. So with that, I'd like to thank you for listening and pause and take your questions.
Okay. We do have, hang on one second back there. We do have some Q&A rules. The first rule is please do wait for the microphone so that everybody can hear your question. And again, we do record the session. Please do slowly state your name and your affiliation. No acronyms, please. You only get one question, so don't try to disguise it as part A and part B. We know that everybody likes to put their question in context, but you do need to keep the context short, and you do need to ask a question. And then finally, the question should relate to tonight's talk. Okay. So I'm going to take the first question because we actually do get some emails with questions. And so I'm going to read a question from a Lieutenant Commander Woods, who is a foreign area officer for the Ballistic Missile Defense Agency, and he's over in the European Engagement Group. So he's probably over in Eastern Europe someplace. And his question goes as so. It says, in ballistic missile defense, sustaining our technical edge against the threat means not only evolving our own capabilities, but also leveraging the indigenous capabilities and innovations of our international partners. Yet we presently consider the overwhelming majority of the information for development, validation, and tactical operation of BMD systems to be US-centric only. To complicate matters, the owners of that data are so widely distributed across government, corporate, and academic domains that no existing body has sufficient jurisdiction to comprehensively evaluate what to share, how, and with whom. So the question is, can you foresee a new approach to addressing these challenges? And if so, what should it look like?
Well, gee, thanks, Duncan. Let's start with an easy one. It's a very good question. And I don't have a magic answer, but I can address a couple aspects of it. First of all, one of the trends I did not touch on in my talk is the internationalization of technology. It's more than just commercial. It's so broad now, and that is part of this. And yes, I do think that there is a growing realization in the Defense Department that if we try to do everything alone, we will miss some big bets. We will miss some new capabilities. We have to work through more rapidly a way to share information about technology, about intelligence, about a lot of things with our dear coalition partners. So I think there's a recognition, and recognition is step one in a problem, but it's not an answer, and I do understand that. I think that also there has been some breakthroughs in sharing equipment with our international partners, and that's an important step towards that. Look at JSF, another JSF example. It's a very international program. Now, the point about the fact that the information is spread all over, well, yes, it is, but at least for missile defense, there's MDA. I mean, there's an awful lot of things going on in the department that are spread all over, and it's difficult to harness together all the implications and set a policy about sharing with our international partners. So I accept that this is a problem for missile defense. At least we have MDA to help with that. I think we need to tackle this more broadly to keep up with our partners and to work together.
As always, you offer a lot. I have one question. Your triangle is fantastic. What I have a problem with is the cost of ownership. Since the first caveman went out on a hunting expedition, the headsman understood, hey, I'm only as good as my people. I take care of them, they'll take care of me. When I came into the service, take care of your people, they'll take care of you. If you all heard the Navy, the Air Force talking about the quality of their people, if we're not for that, we would not be where we are. That ownership cost is not negative. It is not a flat line. It contributes to the modernization and the readiness you talk about. Yet the only time you hear anybody in the service in the uniform saying, I'm going to do something differently. I'm not going to spend as much money on my people. I'm going to take away their retirement benefits. We never hear anybody say, hey, I'm going to do things differently so I don't spend $300 million for a plane. How do you address that in the context of where you sat at the Pentagon?
It's a great point. And I couldn't agree more about the importance of getting it right with regard to our people. And I do think that, you know, we did a little look in CAPE. Everybody's done this analysis of the percent of GDP of the defense budget over time. And it's gone down a lot. But our capability is still huge. And I think it's because the quality of our force is so high. And so I agree with you, but here's how I would address it. First of all, we do talk about getting the cost of planes down, but back to the people. There's two elements of getting the base of that triangle small. The biggest one, and it should be the biggest one, is getting the force smaller. Not paying the people less, but getting the force smaller. And that has been very difficult to do. In fact, it's been mostly denied. Now, the cost of the people in the force is, however, something that we needed to address. When we started back in 2001 and started looking at this, the cost of our people, the pay and benefits of our average military service person actually had fallen down to a level that the department judged as too low. And there were lots of studies. The QRMC said that. Everybody said that. So we embarked purposely on a drill to try to raise the salary and held all of the co-pays and benefits and everything constant. And that went on, and that went on, and that went on to the point that the department would suggest cost of living adjustments to income as we went forward and got healthier, and the Congress would add, and the Congress would add, and the Congress would add beyond what the department asked for. So you get to a point where the cost of personnel was going up 40% relative to the cost of everything else. It was growing very, very rapidly. Too rapidly to sustain, because as much as I agree with you, you can't have very, very highly compensated military with no equipment and no training that sit at home. I mean, you just can't. You've got to have the balance. So the attempt at any changes to compensation and benefits was to slow that growth, not to reduce, not to cut. Now, you talked about retirement. I know there's a retirement commission that's come out, and I'm sorry, not current on it. And I haven't looked at it. When I was there, we actually decided that retirement needed to stay the way it was. There was a proposal from Congress to change the cost of living adjustment. The department went forward. I was part of the, I had to testify. We advocated grandfathering. So retirement's a big deal, and I get it. But all the other things that we did were just designed to slow the growth. Small increases in copays that were denied. And the biggest part of the base of the triangle is the size of the force. Now, given the world that we're in, I understand why people are reluctant to shrink the force, but it's got to align with the dollars. That's the point.
Hi, Colin Agee from Army G2, and I wanted to ask you about your points on autonomous systems. And I really liked your slide about Hollywood. I wanted to start by pointing out the Terminator turned out to be a good guy, and we still don't know if Decker was a replicant or not.
Fair point.
Okay,
did a lot of destruction in the middle there.
But my question is, when you mentioned the de facto imperative we have to keep a human in the loop, I thought of a lot of dumb bomb or dumb systems, for lack of a better term, that are not very discriminate. Booby traps, anti-personnel mines, anti-tank mines. With the proliferation of IEDs, all the IEDs that are not command detonated, and any unobserved indirect fire. So if we tolerate all of the unintentional damage that comes with these dumb systems, why would we set a standard for smart systems that can be empirically proven to be more discriminate than them?
Got it. So, first of all, I don't think we do tolerate it. I think there's been a lot of push over the years to make dumb bombs smart so that we can limit collateral damage. As soon as we got to precision-guided munitions, collateral damage became a target approval criteria. And the unintended civilian casualties were estimated for every target, for example, in Kosovo and in OIF. So, I don't think we tolerate it. That doesn't mean we don't use them, and that doesn't mean we don't make mistakes, so I take your point. You could argue, and actually I've been around this in my own head, that TLAM is an autonomous lethal system. I mean, after you hit the button, it went, the first night of Desert Storm, the CO called up and said, when I hit go, I can't call it back. So what is the line? We've had these debates at APL, and I don't think we satisfied everybody, but lethal robots are a new concept, and I think that they carry these kinds of implications that, again, if we just say, well, it's okay, we can convince people, I think we're missing it. My point is not we shouldn't develop them. My point is that we should develop them with the forethought that they're going to face these kinds of challenges, and we've got to be able to answer the question. You say we can empirically prove. We have to be able to empirically prove. One just quick sea story on this, that one of the engineers at APL who's working on autonomy is actually under contract to try to build training ranges for autonomous systems. That's actually quite an interesting challenge. And so as he was out in the field working on this design, he talked to one of the field commanders, an Army guy, and then he was talking about the use of autonomy. And our analyst, Dave Scheitz's name, said, "Sir, what would it take for you to use an autonomous system?" And he says, "What is the probability that that system is going to do what we want it to do?" He said, "Oh, it's very high. It's 95%. He says, "Well, you come back when it's 100, then I'll think about using it." So it's not just our cultural norms that are a barrier. It's the bar is high within our own force. It's a problem, but it's also something that I think we can master and defeat if we understand it and accept it rather than just push it off. That's my only point. So we have to build this in. We have to have the test range for autonomy so we can show him how reliable it is. And we have to work forward designing these checks in rather than try to just sort of push past them.
Good evening, I'm Timothy Walton with Elias Consulting Group. Thank you very much. My question is, what's your thoughts on the role of campaign level modeling and analysis in OSD force planning? And why do you think CAPE disestablished much of its capability?
Gosh, I wonder where that came from. Okay, so my thoughts are, campaign models are a tool. And in the right hands, they can be a very effective tool. But they are not a substitute for all analysis. And it was my concern that in the department, they were becoming such a substitute. There are real challenges with campaign models. There are real mathematical challenges with them. They are a set of very complex variables that all have to come together. Every one of those variables has a probability distribution about it. And I got news for you guys, errors don't cancel, they add. So when we rely on campaign models as the end-all be-all, it's dangerous. And I thought that much, much too much of the work being done on very hard problems of the kind that I talked to you about tonight, and the budget and the program and the force structure that was necessary, were relying on campaign models. I do think campaign models have a use and a purpose. And again, in the right hands with somebody that understands their limitations, they can play a role. But I think that pulling away from that, doing other kinds of analysis, doing wargaming, using other tools, we have a chance to have a broader set of analytic tools in our kit bag rather than just one. And that was the push that we did from CAPE.
Good evening. Brendan O'Donnell, retired Navy. With the Joint Strike Fighter, before Lockheed Martin got their F-35 contract, there had been at least three rounds of competition that took most of a decade, including an extensive fly-before-buy program. And yet we've had more problems than, and you know better than anybody else what those problems are. And now we're 20 to 25 years down the road. We haven't reached IOC yet. Obviously, concurrent production wasn't the answer. So in order to get to where we need to be in the future and sustain this technological edge, what can we do the next time to compress this development, testing, and fielding cycle?
Yeah. Well, I wish I had that magic answer. I am very concerned about a number of trends that Joint Strike Fighter just illustrates for us. First of all, there was an extensive competition leading up to Joint Strike Fighter. Didn't fix that problem, and I'm not sure what extensive competition we'll have for the follow-on, because the money is so tight. Consolidation is once again upon us, and I am concerned about sustaining a military-industrial complex where competition is really there. So that's one worry that I have. But I do think that when we go into the next big program, we really need to be honest with ourselves. We love to drink our Kool-Aid, don't we? You know, it's gonna be better. Oh, great. It's gonna be faster. It never has been in history. Oh, this time it will be. Yes, we need to look for ways to condense the development cycle. I tried to suggest some of that where you would work some of those kinks out in a process that we would institute before you get into the actual program of record to work those kinks out. But we have to not fool ourselves. It's not magic. And we find over and over and over, yes, our industry gets smarter. Yes, our industry gets better. And we take up that capability by asking it to do more. And so they get better, we want more. They get better, we want more. It doesn't get faster, and it isn't magic. We are the ones, the department, all of us who accepted the promises of the Joint Strike Fighter are to blame for the disappointment in that program. When we step back, and we did this both at CNA and at CAPE, and look at the Joint Strike Fighter program relative to other programs, you know, it's actually not so bad. It's really not. The development cycle is about what you would expect for the complexity of the program relative to other development cycles. The problem is we convinced ourselves we'll build these three planes that are almost the same, but they weren't really, and we're going to do it differently, and it's going to be really fast, and then that didn't happen, and we were all surprised and disappointed. Well, I say shame on us. I think we need to look clear-eyed at these kinds of promises that are really kind of hopes and dreams, and dig into them and look at history, look at data, and make better assessments going in. So at least we go into it with our eyes open. I do think Joint Strike Fighter is going to be a great program. We're going to have a great jet there, and everybody is going to benefit from it. But I sure wish it hasn't been so painful getting there.
Thank you. Is this working? Okay. Christine, riveting, enjoyable.
Thank you.
Charlie Hankin, have my own company, but Christine and I have been in the same organization one time together in the past. So this is to draw you out on a subject that you referred to, but maybe give you a chance to talk more at length about. It's the role of software, the pluses and the minuses. Mm. So, I was project director for the Center for Innovation at Lockheed Martin in Chesapeake, Suffolk, Virginia. And that's where man and man comes together with man, facilitated by software, mm-hmm. and not campaign-level models, but models of stuff, mm-hmm. and see how it works together. And I would submit that's a useful use. It's with an almost no downside use of software. On the F-35 program, just looking at it, I wasn't a member of Aero, but I certainly got a lot of chances to think about the problem. Software lies very much at the heart of the delays that one might have hoped would have been avoided. Yeah, you know, the motor for the Marine Corps thing was a big tech line, but you know, software. And in an age where software is so endemic, crucial, integrated with weapon systems, what are your observations about the downsides from that perspective? So some upsides and some downsides.
Yeah. Thank you, Charlie. You know, I couldn't agree with you more. You know, the ground combat vehicle was going to have more lines of code than JSF. Can you believe it? It's a killer. It's a killer. It is the long pole in the tent every time. And I don't have magic solutions except to say, I think, like a lot of these things, like the JSF conversation we just had, we underestimate how hard it is. And so we start late. We have software engineers on this program. We bring them to the new program late. We think it'll be easy because we did it the last time and it's hard. So I think, I don't know what to do, but I do think we should look at it objectively. As you point out, rightly so, every program suffers from software challenges. And let's anticipate that in the future. Get the best software engineers early. And let's tackle it head on and not expect it to just be easy, because that's whenever we get tripped up, is when we expect it to work, expect it to be easy. Now, I say the best software engineers, that's a problem. I mean, I think that the whole nation is suffering from a huge demand on IT professionals, whether it's cyber or IT or software development for systems. The lab is feeling it. We have a lot of very talented cyber engineers and analysts at APL, and they're always being lured away, and we've been fortunate in keeping a lot of them, but it's a challenge. And so I think that is another problem, and that's where we get back into commercialization. So I don't know if this is going to work. This is a project at the moment that we're working on at APL, but we are thinking about whether there are ways. Take software, you know, okay. maybe we can leverage commercial software knowledge and capabilities. Maybe we can find a way. Okay, they're not developing it for a tank or an airplane, but they know a lot about it. Are there ways we can leverage their skills and assets and bring it in to shorten the time and to have a higher chance of success? I don't know. I really don't. But those are the kinds of things we're looking at. But my biggest theme here is obviously realism. We should just be realistic about these things.
Tom Barnett, I'm with IDA. And so I've seen lots of briefs in my career on science and technology, and lots of slides. MDA was very good at projecting that we were going to invest in science and technology and we were going to achieve great things for missile defense. And ONR has briefs where they'll show a slide and, man, we're investing here and we're going to get stuff. But I was never comfortable that we ever had any real discipline in putting money in front of the process and getting something that was really going to pay off. In a sense, almost like, yeah, I look at the slide, but I think there's a lot of Easter egging going on. So your opportunity to tell us what you would suggest as a way of discipline in the process that will get us the innovation that we need and are looking for.
Yeah. So I don't disagree with you. I think that when you look at the, you know, 6-1 to 6-whatever cycle of S&T R&D, it's not the most disciplined process. Now, some could argue, I have even argued, that you don't want too much discipline if you want an environment of innovation. But you have to have enough so that you get something out of it, that the best ideas are identified and transitioned to the services. We break down very badly in the transition from ONR or DARPA to the services and to a program. And I think that our leaders of those organizations are very aware of it and are working it hard. But again, there's no magic solution here. It happens over here and then it gets thrown over and you're expected to pick it up and, hey, I don't have any money, where am I gonna get that from? So those are some of the challenges we're trying to take on in this concept of more prototyping early on that's in more of a structured way. I know that the process now allows for prototyping, but I'm not sure we do enough of it and that we think about it enough. And then this tech on the shelf concept, which is gonna require a different kind of S&T R&D oversight. I did have an opportunity to talk to Secretary Kendall about it, and he agrees. I mean, these are all things that everybody wants to do. We want to harvest the S&T. We don't have a dollar to waste. We have to develop practically. We have to have a capability to hold on to these ideas. No, we're not organized for it now, and I do worry about it. And I think that we've got to kind of pull together and figure out how to take the next step. As an analyst, a long-term analyst, I know the ideas and the analysis are the fun part. The implementation, that's the hard part. And I hope that we'll have an opportunity to work with everybody to really roll up our sleeves and implement some of these ideas.
Good evening, ma'am. I'm Commander John Schofield. I work at the Naval Academy. The question I had, you brought up Lucius Fox's basement toward the end. And the question I have is, I wonder how you sell that to a very pretty jaded Congress now, and how do you communicate the need or even, you know, the justification for that when you've got programs like JSF, which you've mentioned, but very high profile failures like Presidential Helo. I might even lump LCS into that. Programs that we've had, you know, where you try to leverage all this new technology, you bring in all this requirements creep on you when all you have to do is really keep building DDG-51 or FA-18s. So do you have an idea kind of getting out of the science of it and more to the communication of it? How do you sell this when we just keep, one would submit, failing at high profile new systems in this day and age?
Yeah, so I worry about that too, and I don't have, again, no magic answers, but I think we have to figure out and take it on head on. So first of all, I wouldn't do it as a part of a program of record. That's a fundamental point here because of all the things that you said. And I agree with you about all those programs that have had negative scrutiny, the reputation of the department to be able to field successful programs on time, on budget is not great. Although I have to say that the last couple of years under Secretary Kendall, there wasn't a single Nunn McCurdy. That's a huge achievement. Now he's not, nobody's singing that praise, but I will because that's a big achievement. He has brought a lot of discipline to the department, and it is in a much better place than it was when I first got there in 09. And I think Congress even recognizes it. GAO even cited it. But that doesn't mean they aren't still yelling at us and saying that it's bad, and they should. So what do you do? Well, I think that you have to have it. The prototyping idea and the tech on the shelf idea is not the same kinds of dollars as a program of record. So obviously we report, the department needs to report its S&T budget and what it's doing with it, transparency, all of that should be there. But they're not committing to years of investment when you look at those ideas. That won't happen until something is picked out of the basement at Wayne Enterprises and put into a program of record. So they'll have every opportunity to say yes, no, and look at it at that point. But you're right, we need a communication strategy. We need we need to implement. We need to take the idea, turn it into a process, figure out how much it would cost. We're working on that right now. And then communicate it. Try to build support and then maybe get it in place. So there's many steps to go. And I will take this opportunity to invite everyone here to help me because I think if we don't do something, we're not going to be happy with where we end up when the next upturn comes. So all ideas are appreciated.
Hi, good evening. My name is Greg Schechwiner from the University of Central Florida, and I just want to thank you. This was a fantastic presentation. There aren't many of us from academia in the room, but I wanted to sort of take that Lucius Fox discussion a little bit further. There are a lot of folks down in Orlando that think that they have a little piece of Lucius's workshop.
Yeah.
There are folks at APL that believe that. You know, we have a whole enterprise in the U.S., where we have all these R&D, and supposedly DARPA is out there trying to coordinate and drive a lot of this.
Yeah.
So what message would you send to the universities and the FFRDCs, I guess, as well, about what we should do?
So, okay, thank you for that. Because I think that the universities, the university-affiliated research centers like APL and the FFRDCs are critical. I think they're critical. First of all, I think DARPA is doing a great job, but it's a one office in the entire Defense Department for all innovation is just not practical, right? I mean, everybody, just as you point out, has a piece of this. Good ideas come from everywhere, a Google 9 innovation principle. How do we harvest them? I don't know. But I can tell you, we've just been looking, I mentioned it, commercialization and the trends there, right? So commercialization is important. We can pull from it. But they're not going to develop weapon systems. I mean, Google's not going to go there. It's just not happening. Apple won't even talk to us. So commercialization is not the answer. So what is the answer? The military-industrial complex, absolutely. But it's shrinking. We all know that many of you are from that community. It's shrinking. It's vitally important. We have to sustain it. But we also have to recognize it's getting smaller. The budget is having an impact. So the universities with the good ideas, they're hope, right? They're where the cool things live. How to harness them, how to bring them together, I really don't know. I'd love to work on it, though. We're working on it at APL. Of course, we have the Johns Hopkins connection. Trying to figure out whether or not you just need to visit more. Should we have more conferences? It's not very satisfying because conferences tend to be kind of shallow, right? You know, you don't really get into it. So we need some kind of a process where we can come together and harvest those best ideas, like those lieutenants.